Tom Parker was really that bad?
No, he wasn't bad at all, really. I mean, he was, it's an extraordinary story. And if you want to talk about self-invention, nobody could be more self-invented than he was. But the point is that when they speak about what Colonel did, this and that, they were never in the room. The only people in the room, the only people who knew what the conversations were Elvis, the Colonel, and Vernon Presley.
He's the author of the definitive biography on probably the greatest music icon of all time. Peter Guralnick has written a two-part biography of Elvis Presley. Elvis, The Last Train to Memphis, recently published in Brazil by Belas Letras, and Careless Love, The Unmaking of Elvis Presley, a fascinating piece of work that reveals the man behind the myth. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm very pleased to welcome the writer, music critic, and journalist legend who also has written the biographies of Sam Phillips and Sam Cooke, among other books. We're talking about Peter Guralnick. Peter Guralnick, first of all, thank you so much for being on my show. It's a real honor to be interviewing you. And everything I can ask you today will be too few, I have to say, compared to everything I would like to ask you. So please be welcome in my show and in Brazil, to Brazil too.
Well, thanks. I mean, it's great to be here. I wish we could do it in person. That would be even more fun, but I'm glad to be here.
To be fantastic. Maybe one day when you come to Brazil, maybe when we publish Careless Love, who knows? No?
That would be great.
So, Peter, there are no limits we can attribute to Elvis as an artist, and he was a focal point for the last century, right? And your book, I think your book reverts dimensions and shows the boy who inhabits this huge character, a boy consumed by music with big dreams, but who didn't have the resource to even think about how to make them come true. Revealing Elvis, Peter, from inside out was the big task you set for yourself.
That's true. I mean, I had written about Elvis in the past. I'd written the chapter in the Rolling Stone Illustrated History of Rock and Roll, and I thought that was sort of the end of my involvement with Elvis. Not because I was less interested in him, but because I didn't want to write about him from the outside. It was I used the line from the William Carlos Williams poem, "The Pure Products of America Go Crazy," as the epigraph. Epigraph for the long essay I'd written on. But I just thought, okay, that's as much as I have to say. Then I got started. I started working on a documentary, which eventually I took my name off of, but it was good. It was, and in the course of doing it, I was exposed to all of these interviews that Elvis had done. This is, you've got to remember, before the internet, nothing was available.
Right.
I exposed to all these interviews that Elvis had done in 54, 55 mainly, 55, 56. And I listened to it and I suddenly had this flash of illumination that, Elvis could speak for himself. I mean, he was so eloquent. Everything he said was so to the point. But that didn't matter. I mean, it wasn't that it had to be fancy. It was just this was a real person with genuine passion for the music and a creative vision. And some of that came out in the interview, some of it didn't. And that was really the genesis. And the other part of the genesis, and I've spoken of this in the past, a friend of mine named Rose Clayton, who was a native Memphian and came from South Memphis, and we were driving down Macklemore one day, which is where Stax is, Macklemore Avenue. It's also around the corner from Reverend Brewster's, William Herbert Brewster's church, East Trigg, which Elvis attended with his girlfriend Dixie Lott. But we were driving down and there was a boarded up drugstore, pharmacy. And Rose pointed over there and she says, Elvis used to sit there at the counter waiting for his cousin Jean to get off work. And she said, you know, he would just drum his fingers on the counter. And she said, you know, poor baby. And again, that was so, I mean, Rose called the other day. I haven't seen her in years. And I said, you know, I always give you credit. So I had to give her credit here. But the point, really, the point was, it was just seeing him as this, you know, acneed 17, 18-year-old, but someone who was so, it's what you said, he was so passionate about music. He was an omnivore. He took in everything in the same way that a kid today, you know, who just was consumed with music would. And Elvis had, I mean, he had an incredibly retentive mind. He had a photographic memory. And he, you know, he had all the knowledge that an ethnomusicologist would have today of every aspect of American music, black, white, secular, gospel, and took it all in and absorbed it all. And it wasn't that it all came out instantly, but this was a remarkable person, a remarkable mind. And also he said, once he had achieved success, he was confronted with a remarkable challenge, which he didn't always rise to throughout his life. But anyway, that was a story I wanted to tell, just a real person in a real world, in real terms.
You were not that interested in him as a pop phenomenon?
No, not so much. I mean, I wasn't uninterested in it, but, you know, this would be, again, it's what you said in the beginning of trying to tell the story from the inside out. I mean, for instance, when later on he made his epical recordings at the Memphis recording studio that Chips Moman had in 1969. And I had reviewed that for Rolling Stone. And when the second volume, which we're not going to talk about, but when that came out, when Careless Love came out, and this friend of mine who was a critic, which I don't consider myself to be at all, I don't want to be, but he, you know, he said, well, why didn't you include that review you wrote for Rolling Stone? And I'm saying, it has nothing to do with the story. Elvis wasn't thinking about my review. I mean, I wanted to put myself in his shoes. I wanted to think about what he was thinking about going into the studio, just as I did when he first went into the Sam Phillips's Sun Studio at 706 Union Avenue. And there he is. He's 19 years old. And what was on his mind? What was he thinking? How did that first session come about? How was, you know, and so it's not a story of an iconic figure. It's a story of a real person.
And about the interviews with people like Sam Phillips or Scotty Moore, you've talked several times. And what I think it's very interesting that we talk a lot about the Memphis Mafia and all these guys around Elvis, but there are important women in Elvis' life that you bring up in your book, like Marion Kaisler was very important for Elvis' early
and for me,
recordings.
A wonderful friend.
Yes, and it's amazing how you introduce this character in your book and the first girlfriend, Dixie, or Anne Margaret, then in the other book, a woman who maybe would have been a more equal partner to Elvis. I don't know. Let's speculate here a little bit. But it's amazing
they were all equal partners. That was what he was really very sensitive to women. Although I'm not saying that he always treated them well, but he was very sensitive because they allowed him to reveal his vulnerable side.
In this first volume, we discovered the world in which Elvis grew up, his childhood, the beginning of his career, his love to music, his first hits, the relationship with his parents, friends, and mentors, and also the musical context in which he turns into this phenomenon. You begin with Elvis' birth until the time he goes to the army in Germany after the death of his mother, Gladys.
Which is really the curtain coming down when his mother
dies. Yes. Why did you choose this specific moment to make the cut between the first and second part?
I don't know if I chose it or it chose me, because this was going to be a short, elegant version of Elvis's life. And I hope it's still elegant. It definitely wasn't short. And what it was, after I'd started writing, I suddenly realized that everything was coming to a head with the death of his mother, that this just was such a volcanic event in his life. And in some ways, it took away his faith. He truly believed, he and his mother were sort of spiritual in an instinctive way. And they would see shapes in the clouds, or they would imagine Elvis in particular achieving something which they couldn't fully articulate. His father, he was very close to his father, but he didn't have that sensibility. And he really felt that he had been given the success, the young Elvis did. It was meant to be. This is what he was put on earth to do, and it was for his mother, mother most of all, mother and father. And when his mother was taken away from him, this set him off on a lifelong quest. Well, if she's gone, what am I here for? What was this all about? And it was a genuine, it just shattered him. And so I realized after I had started writing, I was still doing, interviewing people. I mean, I never stopped. I was going out for 3 weeks and I was coming home for 2 weeks. When I started writing, I stayed home for 3 weeks and maybe went out. it just suddenly became clear to me that that it was as if the curtain came down with the death of his mother, and when it went up again after he got out of the army, it was a whole different story. And I called up my editor at the time, and I said, "Are you sitting down?" She was very nice, although there were great changes going on at the publisher, who was not the ultimate publisher. The publisher was sort of devolving. But, I said to her, I said, this is not going to be a one-volume biography. This is a two-volume biography. And she was fine with it, but she got fired right after that, not because of me, but that because the whole publisher was going under at that point. Then when I went out again with the book to the publisher who published it, to Michael Peach at Little Brown, who remains my editor to this day. This was in 92 that we first met for Over Elvis. And he just embraced it right away. But if he hadn't, then he wouldn't have been my publisher. So it was good. He's the best person, the best thing that's ever happened to me in publishing. And he's been a wonderful friend and a truly honorable person in the publishing world. He's now the CEO of Hachette USA. But anyway, so that's why it became the two volumes, and I never thought of it any other way. Once this I had this vision is the wrong word. I'm trying to think of the word which my kids have always told me not to use, never to use again, but I can't think of it right now.
But these two events, the death of his mother and the army, had a strong effect on his career and on his life, right?
I don't know. I don't know if the army had so much of an effect. During the 2 years, and this is not necessarily a popular view, I mean, some people believe it, some people don't, but during the 2 years in the army, he was devastated. He thought his career was over, but Colonel Parker, his manager, who was the best manager in the world at that point for him, I mean, after about 10 years, like many relationships, the thrill had gone. And they probably would have been better off walking away from each other. Neither one of them could. But I mean, Elvis was the one who should have done it, the same way Sam Cooke walked away from every manager once he'd absorbed whatever there was to absorb. But in the army, the colonel wrote him these fantastic letters, bucking up his spirits, telling him all the things that, all the deals he had made, all the things that Elvis had to look forward to when he got out, that his success was going to be even greater than it had been before. And Elvis got ready to make records which would be even greater than the records, from an artistic point of view, than the records he had made before. And he came home with the greatest of ambitions. And if anybody listens to the album he made on his immediate return, Elvis Is Back.
Elvis Is Back is amazing.
It's just an incredible album. I mean, and it covers all the ground that he wanted to cover, and his blues, Reconsider Baby, is great, and Fever is fantastic, and all of these songs, his operatic, It's Now or Never, or Are You Lonesome Tonight, all of these songs covered just a wide range, and he approached them with such passion and such excitement. This is after the Army. So that's why I don't, the Army had an effect on him. And one of the effects it had was that the Army handed out amphetamines at the, what do you call it, the PX, or, you know, the store. And that was really the first time that Elvis had used amphetamines. And he was sold on them, just as many people were, just as John F. Kennedy was. It gave him more energy. You know, he could last longer. He could, you know, it didn't turn out, it didn't work out that well for him in the long run, the amphetamines.
Yeah, I love this, his recording sessions when he gets out of the Army. As you said, Elvis's back is amazing. And the comeback special, which comes after that. But John Lennon has this famous quote, Elvis died the day he went into the Army. And okay, he also said before Elvis there was nothing. But I think this is an opinion repeated by many fans, now, because maybe because of the films and soundtracks he recorded, right?
Well, again, if you listen to the recordings he made, leaving aside the films, the soundtracks, the recordings he made in 61, 62, they're astonishing. And he records these ballads by Don Robertson and by Doc Pomus and Mort Schumann, in which he becomes an interpreter of song in a way that he had never had before. And his voice is so beautiful. I mean, I don't mean to be gushy, but I really think, and I think if, I wish we could talk to John Lennon about it here. I think he just said that on the spur of the moment off the top of his head. I think he would, you know, willingly and gladly retract that statement. It was just, it got attention. He said a lot of things that got attention. No, but he did a lot of things.
Right, I mean, right, right.
You know, it just, and so, yeah, but I think you're right that sort of marked, and you see, the thing is, it marked a lot of people's views of without listening. And the thing about it is, people like to think that, they like to think that, oh, well, he was making all these movies, he just, you know, that didn't challenge him, and that's why he, you know, didn't continue to record great music. The fact is that what happened was he got totally caught up in his spiritual studies. He was fascinated by that himself. Part of it stemmed from his mother's death. He met a guy named Larry Geller, who came in as his hairdresser. And I'm not looking down my nose at Larry Geller. He had the same interests that Elvis did. If I were able to have given Elvis anything, I would give him a course in comparative religion at UCLA, because I think that would have served him better. But he was fascinated in all religions, in Buddhism, in Zoroastrianism, you know, in Gurdjieff, and everything. And
the searcher, Elvis the searcher.
Yeah. I mean, but the point is, from 1964 until the middle of 66, he had zero interest. He didn't go into the recording studio for anything but these soundtracks. And the reason had nothing to do with the movies. He just wanted to read his books. And you can see, you know, some of the examples. I think I did a book called Elvis Day by Day, and we included some of the pages that he had heavily annotated from his spiritual readings. But that was all he wanted to do. And the colonel, his manager, was just tearing out his hair, because he had made extraordinary contracts with RCA, extraordinarily rewarding contracts, but they required the delivery of music. And he just was trying to figure out, how do I get Elvis back in the studio? And essentially, he Red West, I think, and a couple of other people, but it was his plan to get Elvis back in the studio by suggesting a gospel album, which became How Great Thou Art. And that was his first return to the studio in 2.5 years, not because he was discouraged by, I mean, again, everybody thinks that he was discouraged by the movies. Well, maybe so, but I mean, the movies were just a vehicle for him to make enough money so he could do whatever he wanted to do, which in this case happened to be reading his spiritual books.
Which phase of Elvis do you like the most? I have to ask you, sorry.
You know, I don't really know. I mean, he had one of the extraordinary things about his career, and again, it's something that is not necessarily widely embraced, was that there were really three principal periods of creativity, each one of them different from the other. And, you know, a pop star, generally speaking, their stardom runs out fairly quickly. Well, in Elvis's case, you had that just incredible beginning. I mean, just a spontaneous combustion of, you know, his early sides, of the sun sides, and of the success that he enjoyed. So you have that. Then you have him coming back from the army, where he becomes an entirely different kind of singer who does rock and roll, does blues, right, does all kinds of other stuff. Then he sort of has fun, runs into this fallow period when he's reading his books. I mean, I'm oversimplifying, but that really is what he was doing. He joined Diamata at the Self-Realization Fellowship. He told her he wanted to become a monk. She thought his, you know, his talents could be better used. I mean, she was a fascinating person, Diamata. She was the protege of Yogananda, you know, who wrote
Yogananda.
Yeah, who wrote Autobiography of a Yogi. Mm-hmm. And her story is quite fascinating. And
the favorite book of George Harrison, by the way.
Autobiography of a Yogi.
Yes.
Well, I don't know. I mean, it's amazing because it's sort of like Elvis was dismissed in some ways as not being serious, and yet he was very, very serious, sometimes to the point of monomania. But anyway, so you have that. Then he comes back into the studio in the middle of 66, and I think you have a period there where from 67 through 70, maybe, he has a renaissance, you know, being reborn. And he puts out these singles. That was when I first wrote about Elvis in 67, sort of writing about these three singles. One of them was Guitar Man and one was U.S. Mail. But he did You Don't Know Me in there. And I'm going to forget what the other titles were. Mm-hmm. But I wrote this kind of naive article for an underground paper called Boston Phoenix. It was Boston After Dark then. And, you know, about how Elvis is back. He's going back to his roots. And, you know, I'm an idiot, but still, you know, when I wrote the biography, in a way, that was what happened. His passion was rekindled for music. Then he did the 68 special, which you mentioned. Then he did the sessions at American Studio with Chips Moman. The album came out from Elvis in Memphis. That was an extraordinary thing. Then he went into Las Vegas with the idea of covering every aspect of the music that he loved, every single strand of it. And he was totally serious, totally committed. I don't particularly like that, you know, the music. I think mm-hmm. it's overblown, you know. But again, I'm not trying to take that away from anybody. That's just my reaction, and people love it. But more than that, Elvis was totally committed to it in the beginning. He was doing everything. He was putting himself entirely into it. So
totally engaged.
Yeah. So I mean, you know, I'm not going to choose. I mean, I guess if I
okay.
No, I mean, I'll say if I had to, it's like, you know, if I had to be left with one thing that I could never, you know, the only thing on this pathetic little desert island that I was living on, that I could, you know, take with me, it would be seeing Howlin' Wolf one more time live in a small club. But if I had to do the same with Elvis, I suppose it would be the sun sides in that early thing, because they're so pure and they're so, he doesn't have the technical, you know.
It's Elvis music, right?
Yeah, it's Elvis music. It's what are you going to call it? It's not. I mean, there was no such thing as, I mean, it just is not, you can call it rock and roll. It was a marketing tool, but that's not what it is. It's so pure. It's just purely itself.
Peter, Elvis was, and perhaps still is, the target of many prejudices and criticisms for being revolutionary, for being popular, for breaking taboos, for dancing, for being a redneck, and for cultural appropriation of African-American music. I mean, Elvis is huge, but he's also been misunderstood a lot. Does it make sense to think that he co-opted African-American music, for example?
No. I mean, that's a misunderstanding of the whole music business and music industry. I mean, think of it this way. Ray Charles wrote songs. I mean, in addition to recording them, he wrote them. Did he want to see his songs restricted to African-American representation? He wanted everybody to record it. He wanted Lawrence Welk to record them as polkas, because that's the source of all income. All the entire music industry is built on music publishing. It's like the purest kind of capitalism. Now, I'm not speaking up for capitalism. I mean, I think that there are many, I think that's the root of much evil. And that's the root of a great deal. Not so much it's of racism, but much more to the point, it's of classism. It's the way in which every artist, black or white, who lacked the educational tools, in the music business, carry this over to many other places, but not taken advantage of. I mean, it's the whole basis for a law school education. You don't learn to communicate at law school. You learn to obfuscate. You learn to hide the truth so that people who have not had that training can't read a contract. Colonel Parker said, I'm not interested in any contract that's more than one or two pages long and in plain English. Because if you can't say it in plain English, you're just trying to fool me. And although the contracts, it turned out to be more than two pages long, they basically represent his belief. So it's simply people, when I first interviewed Howlin' Wolf, who was maybe the purest representation of African-American expression of the blues, or as pure as anything else. And he talked to me about that blues singer from Memphis. And at first I didn't know who he was talking about. And it was Elvis he was talking about. And I mean, I was afraid to say it because I thought, God, I'm going to look like such a fool. I was like 22 years old. Oh my God, I can't say Elvis. You mean Elvis? But he did. He met Elvis and he had great regard for Elvis because he expressed what he had to say and sing passionately with his own feeling, his own form of expression. Now, Howlin' Wolf also told me at that first interview and later about how one of his principal influences, or maybe his principal influence, was Jimmy Rogers, the father of country music. And he told a story about how he had learned his howl from Jimmy Rogers' yodel. There was no sense of cultural appropriation. With Elvis, when he recorded That's All Right by Arthur Big Boy Crudup, it had been a minor hit in 1946 for Arthur Crudup in the R&B market. That was it. It was dormant. Elvis loved that song. When he recorded it 8 years later, he wasn't taking anything away from anybody any more than, any more than anything. But he was, right. It was the only way that that song or that artist could ever have made any money from his music would be if it didn't matter if it was Elvis or it was Frank Sinatra or if it was Ray Charles. But the point was somebody had to record the music and Elvis wasn't taking away Arthur Big Boy Crudup's hit. But similarly, and this is a point people just don't consider. What about Elvis recording Bloomin' Rose, Blue Moon of Kentucky? What did Elvis have to do with the Appalachian tradition from which Bill Monroe came? Absolutely nothing. He had no more, claim on that than he did on, Mississippi blues. In fact, he had more claim on the Mississippi blues, having grown up with it from childhood on. But he sang it in his own way, with his own approach, his own passion. And when people said at the time in 54, people said, boy, Bill Monroe must have been mad. Bill Monroe was so mad that he took the royalties that came from Elvis's recording of his song and he went out and re-recorded the song himself, which had been a waltz, in 4/4 time. He may have preferred it as a waltz. I mean, I would say his version as a waltz was much better. He recorded the Stanley Brothers also doing Elvis's version. So, I mean, music is in the air. Once the phonograph and then the radio were invented, music went everywhere. It was no longer confined to some small little island. It went everywhere. It influenced everybody. So that James Brown influenced African music and African music influenced James Brown. So it just, people really misunderstand, I think, when they think of cultural appropriation, they misunderstand what it's based on.
And you mean Elvis did open doors?
He did. Well, I mean, sure, he opened doors. That was what Sam Phillips, his vision was. I mean, when Sam mm-hmm. Phillips started recording, he was recording nothing but African-American artists, and what he imagined was going to happen back in 1951, when he had a huge hit with Ike Turner's Rocket 88, was this was going to open up the doors, not for some white artist to come in, but for black music to be embraced by everybody. And that this, in a sense, was, I mean, he gave interviews at the time in 51. He was 28 years old, you know, and he gave interviews about how this was going to be a pop hit across the board. And that isn't exactly what happened. And ultimately, the way it happened is what you said, is that what happened was that through Elvis's success, all of a sudden the pop market exploded, the rock and roll market exploded. And this opened the doors for Chuck Berry, Little Richard, Ray Charles, who in the previous generation would have been nothing but rhythm and blues stars, big rhythm and blues stars. But and in this generation, in the generation that followed, that immediately followed, or really was almost coincided with Elvis's success, they became huge pop stars and icons of their own. Chuck Berry, I mean, you know, who could be bigger than Chuck Berry, or Bo Diddley, or Little Richard, or Fats Domino? What Sam Phillips's vision, Sam Phillips was the first person who recorded Elvis, and that's a big part of the story in Last Train to Memphis. But that was what he imagined would happen. It just happened in a different way.
And once people embrace the music, the doors are open, and that's what Sam Phillips saw, and Elvis saw this too, right?
He did, absolutely. And when Elvis, for instance, when he opened in Las Vegas in 69, and somebody, you know, at the press conference after the show, somebody said, "You're the king of rock and roll." He says, "I'm not the king of rock and roll. That man back there," and he pointed to Fats Domino, who was in the crowd. He said, "That man back there, Fats Domino, he's the king of rock and roll." Just like Jerry Lee Lewis's mother told Jerry Lee Lewis, you know, that Chuck Berry is the king of rock and roll. She said, and Jerry Lee Lewis looked astonished at his mother. He said, "What does that do? What does that say about me, Mom?" Mama, yeah.
You also wrote a book, as I said before, about Sam Phillips, the man who invented rock and roll. What's the importance of this meeting? Not only, I mean, Elvis and Sam Phillips, not only for Elvis' career, but for music, for pop music.
Sam Phillips' whole entire mission, whether he was working with Elvis or Howlin' Wolf or Ike Turner or B.B. King, you know, or Rufus Thomas or all these artists, that, or Jerry Lee Lewis, was to bring out what was inside the artist that he was recording, to allow them to express themselves in a way that they might not even be able to imagine that they could if the you know, all the filters were not taken down. And that was everything that he considered himself, in a certain sense, a psychologist. Sometimes he waited around, sometimes he made a suggestion, but he didn't direct a session. For instance, Rick Hall, who was one of the founders of Southern Soul in Muscle Shoals, this is in the 60s at Fame Studio. I've been to lots of sessions with Rick Hall, and he demanded precisely, he'd say, "Okay, Danielle, I know you're too close to the microphone there. No, you should be expressing yourself in this way. Let's do that again." And he produced great records, but that was absolutely, totally different, you know, a different approach than Sam Phillips's. And when he first had, Elvis in the studio on July 5th, 1954, he brought him in with Scotty Moore and Bill Black to accompany him. And it was really an audition session. It wasn't intended to. And Elvis did absolutely everything that he could think of. He did country, he did ballads, he did Hawaiian, not Hawaiian music, but Bing Crosby songs, Ink Spot songs. And it wasn't that none of it was any good. Sam Phillips could recognize this was a unique talent. But at the same time, none of it offered an opportunity for the kind of mass acceptance or the breakthrough that Sam Phillips felt. They got to a certain point in the session. Elvis, Scotty, Bill Black all had day jobs. It was time to go home. They were drinking, they had Cokes. And Elvis, sensing that his opportunity, maybe he'd never have another opportunity, sensing that the opportunity was slipping away, Elvis started strumming away or banging away on his guitar, singing a song which was totally unlike anything else that he had sung so far, singing Arthur Big Boy Crude Ups, That's All Right. And at that point, Sam, who often, when he was in the control room, he would pretend, in a sense, not to be paying attention, because he wanted his artists. He wanted Howlin' Wolf, for example, who was one of his greatest artists ever. He wanted Howlin' Wolf not to be paying any attention to him. And in this case, it wasn't that he thought something was going to happen, but he just was, you know, preoccupied, or acted like he was preoccupied. And the instant he heard Elvis go into, "That's all right," and Scotty and Bill sort of joined in, he just snapped to attention, and he said, you know, and he said, "What's that you're doing?" And Scotty said, we don't know. And Sam Phillips said, "Well, all right, go back to the beginning and do it again." And that was, they did maybe two takes survive. "Oh, that's all right." And he had it out within a day or two. He had an acetate out, and then he recorded the follow-up a couple of days later, and the single was out almost instantly. And Elvis was just a hit in Memphis. He wasn't a hit all over the place, but that's where he was. But the book, Last Train, begins not with Elvis. It begins with Sam Phillips and Dewey Phillips in the drugstore in the basement of the Peabody Hotel, which is at the center of Memphis. And the reason I did that, in a way, it's modeled after Taylor Branch's Parting the Waters, his great first volume of his account of Martin Luther King, where he begins with the minister who preceded Dr. King in Montgomery, a long 60-page thing. But I wanted to, and so I was sort of inspired by that. And I wanted to begin not with Elvis, but with two people who, when they met in 1950, had no idea who Elvis Presley was anymore. He listened to Dewey Phillips. Dewey Phillips was a disc jockey on the radio. There's no question Elvis listened to him, but he didn't know either man. But they're talking, they're meeting, they're talking, they're envisioning a world in which the music that they loved, the African-American music that they loved, would someday be accepted by everybody. And I wanted to make that point so that, I wanted it understood from the very beginning, this isn't just the story of a single person. It's not hero worship. It's a story of a world that was evolving. And here were two people mm-hmm. who were influential on Elvis, very much influential on Elvis, but who also saw the same vision, the same world emerging that Elvis saw too, or Elvis would come to see. Elvis was only 15 at the time when they first met.
Peter, you are writing a book about Colonel Parker, right?
That's right, yeah.
So let's talk about him, the man who was inseparably connected to Elvis' career more than anybody else and always had a bad reputation among fans. Tom Parker was really that bad?
No, he wasn't bad at all, really. I mean, he was. It's an extraordinary story. And if you want to talk about self-invention, nobody could be more self-invented than he was. You know, coming over to this country as, you know, without papers, enlisting in the army, finding a new identity, serving for 4.5 years in the army, and then joining the carnival world. But the thing that I think, two things about Colonel Parker. The book, by the way, is made up predominantly of his letters, which are just extraordinary. I mean, he got through the fourth grade in Holland. That was his entire education. Letters are so eloquent. They're revelatory. They show tremendous, they're funny, very funny at times. They just show tremendous attention to detail, and they show tremendous empathy with Elvis. And the relationship of Elvis and him is something I think that nobody has ever understood, because nobody was ever in the same room. I mean, I know most of the guys who were around Elvis. I mean, most of them are gone now. And Jerry Schilling, who has been a very good friend, has a very different perspective than most of the guys on the Colonel. But the point is that when they speak about what Colonel did, this and that, they were never in the room. The only people in the room, the only people who knew what the conversations were Elvis, the Colonel, and Vernon Presley. And the letters really reveal what they are, but particularly at the beginning, when you see Elvis, when you see the Colonel just discovering not a money source, but someone in whom he believed so extraordinarily, someone for whom he had such great feeling, someone to whom he could say, "You and I are much the same. We're easily hurt, but only by those we love." I mean, is that something you would expect to come from the colonel that has been documented, you know, in the relationship?
Not at all.
At every stage, the colonel defended Elvis. At the beginning, RCA was totally, the record company was totally freaked by Elvis's appearances on TV. They're saying to the colonel, this is the beginning of 56, pull him back, tell him he can't do this. The colonel says, the hell with you. He will do whatever he wants to do. He is an artist.
And they used to say that Elvis chose Colonel Parker and not the other way around.
Yeah, because Colonel Parker was a superstar and Elvis wanted to appear on the world stage. He wanted to have that kind of, you know, exposure, which nobody else could have gotten for him. The colonel had managed Eddie Arnold for, I'm trying to think how many years, for 9 years, eight or nine years, to a position where Eddie Arnold was the biggest superstar, is the only word for it, that you could ever imagine in country music, bigger than Garth Brooks, bigger than anybody. He had the number one record on the country music charts, I think for, but he had the number one record for almost 2 years in a row. He just achieved an extraordinary success. But the thing with the Colonel, at the very beginning, when Elvis was first signed with RCA, and the Colonel got William Morris, the talent, biggest talent agency around, interested and involved, which was not an easy thing to do for this kind of music. And when they suggested, a man named Harry Kalshan, who ran the New York office, said, listen, I think we can get Elvis a movie short, which is the kind of the way that you would expose, not a feature movie, not a movie, but a movie short that would appear, you know, before the feature. And this would be a way of exposing Elvis. And the colonel said to him, what are you talking about? This is somebody with the talent of James Dean. This is not, you know, he wasn't saying, oh, we just want to be in a feature. He's saying this is, and he defended Elvis and he's fought for him in a way that I think nobody who has bought into the image of the colonel that's been promulgated could imagine. But one point of correction, until Elvis started having his own problems, maybe, let's say for the sake of argument, you know, in 66, 67 is when they became apparent. And he was, the colonel was really almost universally looked up to in the music world. You didn't have people saying, oh, what's the colonel done to him? It just didn't exist. And he got awards, he got accolades. It's certainly inside the music industry. I'm not sure how much, you know, people outside of the industry were aware of him. But he believed that the artist always wears the white hat. And if Elvis was going to get into trouble, as he did, particularly in 67, 68, he got in trouble by failing to show up. He clearly had drug problems. And the colonel took the heat for that. There was never any criticism of Elvis right up until his death.
How close did you get to him?
The colonel was like an extraterrestrial chess player. I mean, you know, it was like I would think of moves. I mean, I was always trying to argue, you know, not argue with the colonel, but tell him why it was important for him to tell his story. Because, you know, he would say, well, you've got that all wrong about something I'd written. And I'd say, well, yeah, because I don't know what, you know, I don't have your side of the story. And he said, well, you just shouldn't write anything unless you have the whole story. I said, well, okay. But unless you talk to me, I said, this is the only way people will know what the whole story is. But I was like this neophyte. I was like this 8-year-old chess player playing against a grandmaster. And he would always, I mean, and I always learned something from the way he turned the conversation around, always. And after he told me, Peter, I can't tell you anything because, you know, if I did, I'd have to tell everybody and they, you know, it would seem unfair that I was confiding in you. And then he would always tell me something, or if he didn't tell it to me directly, he would suggest to me where I might go, but I had to listen. I had to be listening all the time. but what I was going to say was that it was in those last years, I saw the Colonel and Sam Phillips together. That was how I met the Colonel, was through Sam Phillips. Because I followed Sam to the Colonel's table at the Elvis birthday celebration in 87. I thought that was as close as I would ever get. And the Colonel, but in those last few years, Sam acknowledged that the colonel had taken Elvis places, and though he didn't fully approve of everything the colonel had done, but he did acknowledge that the colonel was somebody who had taken Elvis places that nobody else could have taken him. And he also said, you know, and he kept people away from Elvis in a good sense. I mean, I don't mean in the sense he was trying to keep Elvis in a gilded cage or something, but he was able to scare people off who would have taken advantage of Elvis. So, I mean, it was interesting watching them together. Most amazing thing I ever saw with Elvis, and with Sam and the Colonel, was at the Colonel's 80th birthday party. I've got a picture of that in my, I guess I got a picture in Sam Phillips' biography, but also in the most recent book I wrote, Looking to Get Lost. And you've got the Colonel and Sam were just going at it hammer and tongs about the exact way that events had transpired. This is in 89. I mean, this is when the birthday was. And the exact way that events had transpired in October and November of 1955, when Colonel arranged for Elvis's contract to be sold to RCA. And each of them was in full command of so much detail. And they all, each of them remembered the detail, but they looked at it from an entirely different perspective. And I'm standing there in the shadows. You can see me in the picture. And, you know, listen to this, you know, and it's just, and then Sam said to me, well, you know, you got to come to breakfast with us tomorrow because we're going to continue this. And I had to leave, you know, I had to leave that night. And I was just devastated. I thought, that's it. I missed the whole story. But the story went on.
Always. And have you finished the book about Colonel Parker or?
No. I mean, I've selected the letters pretty much. But I'm now writing a long introductory sort of biographical portrait. It'll be 40 or 50,000 words. It'll be a lot like the portrait I did of the country singer Dick Curlis in Looking to Get Lost. It's like a real life novella. Not a telenovela, just a novella. You know.
Well, and I think that we get to know a different version of Tom Parker in your book, right?
Oh, I think so. I think entirely different. And, you know, whether people buy it or not, I know some people will never buy it, and they're probably going to be upset with me for. But I'm not writing a defense of Tom Parker. I'm not being his, you know, his attorney for the, you know, I mean. And I'm not writing a condemnation. I'm just I want to write something that's true, that's as true as what I've written about Sam Cooke or Sam Phillips or Elvis, and that allows people to see him in an objective way, not through the lens of prejudice.
Peter, the second part to be released in Brazil soon, picks up where you left in the first here and leads us until Elvis' death.
Because in Last Train to Memphis, the external story, just writing an account of how Elvis's life proceeded, was compelling in itself. It's such a wonderful story. It's the ultimate Horatio Alger story, a story of, you know, youthful dreams and youthful success. Now, the external story in Careless Love, if I were to tell the story of each movie he made, it's just not interesting. The movies aren't interesting. Telling the story of it. And so the Colonel becomes much more of a character, almost like a character out of Falstaff. The character Falstaff in Henry V or something. And what he's doing is extremely interesting in terms of trying to keep Elvis's career together and all that. But I'll give you an example of the, you know, different sources of inspiration. You may laugh at me, but the part of the inspiration for Careless Love, in my mind, I mean, it inspired me, was a new translation at the time of Anna Karenina by a husband and wife couple, where I thought it was so caught up in the grand passion and the downward spiral. And you know, I don't know that anybody could see it. I mean, it's probably stupid of me to mention it, but that is that truly was what, and that's a very great difference from Last Train to Memphis, you know, which, it's almost a total difference, but you know, there were many moments but I don't think any moment was more emotional for me than the death of Elvis's mother, Gladys, at the end of Last Train, and the effect on Elvis, just the absolute catatonic effect, and his first girlfriend Dixie coming up to the house and his having to see her. I mean, she wasn't dressed to see him; she wasn't there, to, you know. And they're commiserating, and they're just talking about how their world had you know, Gladys was gone, the world had ended. She wasn't his girlfriend anymore. I mean, I found that just devastating.
But there was a connection between Elvis and Dixie, and the mother, the Gladys, were very close to her. And
yeah,
I remember this.
Yeah. It was a tremendous connection. But I mean, it was Elvis's connection to his life. It was, you know, his connection to everything that preceded, you know, fame just enveloping him. Or, you know, so
it was a mystical relationship between Elvis and his mother. It was love, and it was much more than love, I think. That's what I felt reading your book. That was really a very deep connection, very mystical connection.
Yeah, no, I think they had the same kind of sensibility. And again, you know, one of the things I ran into, I don't know if I would again, but when I first published Last Train, that was a while ago, and I went out on these book tours and stuff, and people wanted to see Elvis as a freak. How could he love his mother so much? And I said, well, you know, people have different relationships with their parents and mothers. But I said, when Duke Ellington's mother died, he wasn't able to write a note of music for over a year. And nobody called him. It's just, you know, I just feel like you've got to have an extended breadth of understanding and empathy. People aren't all the same. And it was what you said. It was a remarkable relationship. They shared, to a remarkable extent, a similar sensibility.
It's a beautiful relationship. That's what you showed us. And I think you give us a new perspective about the relationship between Elvis and Vernon and his father too. You realize how connected they were in another way.
I hope so. I mean, you know, it's funny because when I wrote Last Train, I hadn't had access to the archives of Graceland. I hadn't been able to get it. And only after the book came out, I got a letter from Jack Soden, who's still the president of Elvis Presley Enterprises in Memphis, and a wonderful guy. But he wrote, he says, Peter, you know, if you were to write me the letter, same letter you've been writing me the last 3 or 4 years, which was to, you know, could I get access to the archives? You know, I think you'd get a different answer. So I did, and I got a different answer, and I got into the archives. And there I found, you know, things about Vernon. I found postcards from prison. My wife Alexandra, you know, went through. I mean, it was just an amazing experience. We found, you know, bills that for furniture that Vernon had bought on in time. You know, where you buy it and you put down a certain amount of money and you keep paying. And 10 years, or maybe not 10 years, but even after Elvis achieved success, Vernon is still paying it off. I saw all the jobs that he took. So by the time that Last Train came out in paperback, I had rewritten to some extent, not to a major extent, but rewritten, used different adjectives, I tried to give Vernon a more, not just sympathetic role, but a genuine role. And so I hope most readers will see, you know, take it the way you saw it, because that is, that's the way I intended it, was he did have an extraordinary relationship with Vernon, and Vernon had you know, a dry sense of humor. Again, these are people who didn't have the benefit of schooling and who were looked down upon by so many people. I mean, Elvis and the Colonel just delighted themselves in telling the tales of how these grand high poobahs in Hollywood looked down upon them as just, you know, as rednecks, as just idiots. Well, and this was what Elvis enjoyed the most. Well, the Colonel was taking them for everything they were worth. And Elvis and the Colonel, you know, they were smarter than these people. And Vernon was not given credit, I think, for his native intelligence and for his dedication to his son.
One last question, Peter. What do you think that Elvis could have done if he would have lived longer?
Well, had he gotten off of his dependency on, you know, like, let's call it prescription medication, but I mean drugs, or, you know, just, had he been able to get off of that, had he been able to shake off the depression, I think the thing that would have given him the greatest source of contentment and happiness would have been to return to gospel music, which was his first
gospel book. Music, right?
And I think, you know, what he did in gospel was extraordinary. And if you listen to His Hand and Mine, which he recorded right after he got out of the army, or How Great Thou Art, which is the one time he sang with Jake Hess, you know, one of his idols all of his life. But I think that he could have continued to develop that. And I think it would have been a source of satisfaction far greater than anything he could have achieved in the pop field. On the other hand, it couldn't have given him the income or the, you know, I mean, if you're going to keep giving, let's say, for the sake of argument, one of the reasons he gave away all those cars and all that money was, in addition to generosity, was also maybe lack of self-esteem or just the need to get gratitude back from people or whatever. So let's say he'd gotten beyond all that. That was part and parcel of this clinical depression that he suffered from. And he didn't need it, then he wouldn't have needed as much money. And I think he could have made his mark in gospel, not just as somebody who was calling back, you know, days of the past, but someone who was forging ahead on a new path in gospel. And I think that would have given him enormous satisfaction, both artistically and spiritually too.
Right. Well, I think that you probably won't find someone who puts himself more into a song than Elvis.
Cock in the Trap.
Right. Absolutely, absolutely. Peter Guraunic, I want to thank you so much for this interview. I'm sure all Brazilian Elvis fans do too. You cannot imagine our joy in finally being able to see this book published in Brazil. Let's say it again, the second volume, Careless Love, will be published in Brazil by Belas Letras as well. We also look forward to getting a Brazilian edition of your biography of Sam Cooke and Sam Phillips, by the way.
I think that's what Brazil needs.
Absolutely. By the way, Peter, I just realized that I finished an amazing trilogy of interviews, three biographers called Peter. Peter Ames Carlin on Bruce Springsteen, mm-hmm. Peter Doggett on Beatles, and Peter Guraunic on Elvis. Isn't that great?
you've done me one better. I had two biographies of Sam. And when people said, okay, what's your next biography going to be after Sam Phillips? I said, well, it's got to be somebody named Sam. But I never did it.